Bismillah walhamdulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam, and welcome to part 4 of the third installment, which deals with al-Isra and al-Mi'raj journeys. And as I have already stated, that these two, al-Isra and al-Mi'raj journeys, are extremely important to the topic of as-salat. And that is because Muslims, the majority of Muslims, believe that as-salat was made compulsory on the Messenger of Allah in these nights. I have already explained and spoken about the differences about the dates of when this event took place. And please do get back to my previous talks to get a better idea. This idea about Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj being a key to As-Salat is really a huge deception, because As-Salat was ordained and prescribed on the Messenger from the very first day that he was made a Messenger. The Quran speaks abundantly about this, and I will speak about this particular topic in the next installment, that is the fourth one, where I will speak about As-Salat from Al-Quran. This talk, or this series of talks, deal with the issue. There is a particular question that people ask you whenever you want to push Al-Quran and say that the Quran is the sole authority in Al-Quran, we don't need anything else. They will straight away jump. And this is a unanimous practice that almost every Muslim does it. And I have had this asked to me by regular Muslims and even by sheikhs, would you believe it? But alhamdulillah, the answer is here. But the reason behind them asking this question is, then how did we know that Dhuhr is 4 and Maghrib is 3 and Isha is 4 and so on and so forth? Because what they're doing is they expect you to say, oh, it is not in the Quran. And then they will tell you, how did you learn it? And then you go, oh, it's from the Hadith. They will tell you then, why do you accept the Hadith just in As-Salat and you refused in everything else? Little do these people know that this question is answered in Al-Quran. And this, I will speak about this in the next installment, as I said. But this is not, this one here is about Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. I have already spoken about around 30 points that will be discussed in this last installment, the last part of installment number 3 about Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. Please do get back to my table of content that I did, where I mentioned the different points, because predominantly there are 2 points that will maybe stick out, if that is correct. That is the origin of Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. And you're going to be extremely, extremely surprised, because I will mention to you the text from the Bible, and all you have to do is take away the names that are mentioned in the Bibles and put that of Muhammad, and that's it. You will have Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj in all of its glory. And also I will speak about issues like, is the Jannah created now, or was it created when the Messenger was alive? Did he enter paradise? Did he enter hellfire? Did he see people punished in hellfire? Because we all know that people will get punished after judgment day. No one is going to be punished before judgment day. So if the Messenger of Allah has seen people in hellfire being punished, or others in Jannah enjoy it, so which part exactly of the time spectrum are we talking here? Did Allah already raise judgment day and he judged these people and put them in paradise? All these questions are extremely important. So as I said, it is common belief today that anywhere you look, really, Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj journeys have become extremely implanted in Muslims' beliefs. And what I mean by this is that if you tell people that you don't believe in Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj, they will straight away consider you as a disbeliever, which in fact it's not true. But as I've already mentioned in other installments before, that we will see why people have gone all the way out of their path in making Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj part of faith when they are not. So before we answer the aforementioned two questions, as I said, the origins of Israa and Al-Mi'raj, and has the Messenger of Allah seen or enter paradise or hellfire, along with the other 30 and so points that I've already mentioned in my table of content, let us create a link between this talk and the talk that I made before to create some form of cohesion between the two talks. If you remember, I said that the inhabitants of Mecca were all concerned with the message that Muhammad brought to them. Suddenly, here they are with somebody they have known for 40 years or so, and suddenly he starts and tells them that he is a messenger sent by Allah. The Arabs are extremely stubborn. They will not accept that you become their president or king or their manager or whoever their superior. Just like that, they will not. And even today, it's a big problem that the Arabs face. So when Prophet Muhammad came to them and said, hey, look, I am sent by Allah, what did they do? They presented a list of demands to Allah. If you do these demands for us, we will believe. And actually, if you do one of these demands, we will believe. We're not going to be extremely fussy. They just put a list of things they wanted Allah to just give them, present to them, and then they will do that. Keep in mind, my dear sisters and my brothers, Allah really loves it that people believe in Him. The Quran and the Messenger of Allah have struggled with people because the Quran struggled to get to the hearts of people and the Messenger struggled to take the message to people. And since the Prophet is a human being, he used humanly possible ways to convey the Quran to people. Allah has in the Quran told the people in Mecca that actually, he would love it for them that they believe, because he doesn't want to punish anybody. Look at it this way. On Judgment Day, when Allah resurrects the people of Mecca and asks them, why didn't you believe when I sent you a messenger? They would tell him, look, Ya Allah, when we needed you, when we were shocked and taken by surprise by Muhammad, all we needed from you was just to show us one sign, just one. If you had answered one of our demands, we would have believed. But you didn't. You didn't respond to us, Ya Allah. You left us in the dark. Then, of course, as the books of Sirah and history tell us, when the messenger was in Al-Madinah, he had tons of miracles happening in his life. Then the people on Judgment Day would tell, Ya Allah, then a few years later, when Muhammad went to Al-Madinah, you went ahead and gave him all kinds of signs and miracles. And the best part of it, nobody ever asked the messenger to produce any miracles for them. In Mecca, we asked you, you didn't give us. The people of Al-Madinah didn't ask, or the Arabs after he migrated didn't ask, and you gave them. You let us down when we asked for signs over and over and over. But you never did that thing to help us. But you helped the people of Al-Madinah. So here is a little bit, a small list of what they asked, the demands that they made of the messenger, because one of these demands, or two of them, really link directly to the talk of Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj. And they, i.e. the people of Mecca, told the messenger, we will not believe in you till you spring from the earth water for us. Of course, you would expect people in the desert, all they long for is water. So that is a really justified request. And then they said, and if you can't do that, that you have gardens with palm trees and vineyards, and that you make rivers flow abundantly inside your gardens, i.e., if your God doesn't want to give us water because of us, let him give you a garden with palm trees and vineyards of grapes and all that kind of stuff, and let him make rivers flow abundantly inside your gardens. That's it. It's for you. It's not for us. But all you need to do is see them. And if he couldn't or didn't want to do that for you, why don't you make the sky fall on us as punishment, as Allah promised in the Quran, and make it fall in pieces as you pretended? Or that you bring Allah and the angels before us face to face. Let us meet this God of yours. Let us see these angels of yours. Let us meet them face to face. Once we see them, we will believe. Or, if you don't want to do that, that you get a house made for you from gold. Next day we wake up, we find you living in a house of gold. You do that, or any of what you have asked, we would believe. And then here is the kicker. This is the most important part. Or that you ascend into heavens. And here they are asking Muhammad to go in heaven, what we call Al-Uruj, Al-Mi'raj, is the ascension to heaven. And then they tell him, and we will not believe in your ascension until you bring down for us a book that we can read. See, and then they tell him, they tell them that, okay, Rasulullah one day went to heaven. It just doesn't make sense. So how did Allah answer them? How did the good loving God that we worship, how did he answer back to them? Guess what? He did not answer any of their demands ever. He didn't make the rivers flow for them. He didn't give palm trees and vineyards to Muhammad. He didn't give him rivers that flow abundantly in his gardens. He didn't send the sky down upon him to punish them. Allah didn't come and he didn't face them with the angels. No house of gold was built for Muhammad, and no ascension to heaven was ever made. You see, that all this because circumstances do not affect Allah's decision. Keep in mind, my dear sisters and my brothers, Allah's messenger was going through very difficult times. Not many people had answered his call when he was in Mecca. In the 13 years that he lived in Mecca, less than 80 people had embraced Islam. That is an average of 6 people each year. This means that any help from Allah to the messenger would make his task really, really easy. But that didn't happen. Allah didn't interfere with people's choices. Allah doesn't want any responsibility on Judgment Day. He doesn't want to push you to believe, and he doesn't want to push you not to believe. You decide what you want to do, and Allah helps you in both ways. If someone wants to disbelieve, Allah will help them disbelieve, because that is a choice they made. And if you choose to believe, then Allah will help you believe. What if Allah had answered the people of Mecca and he gave them at least one of their demands? Wouldn't the messenger be in a better position? Wouldn't the number of believers increase? Well, guess what? The answer to this is extremely simple, focused, and objective. Allah ordered his messenger to answer them with one term, and he says, tell them subhanallah. The term subhanallah is wrongly translated in books of Quran, either translations or explanation, and they say, exalted is my Lord. Look in the translation, go to the Quran and watch in Surah Al-Israa. They will say exalted, but this has nothing to do with that. Why would Allah order his messenger to glorify him when the inhabitants of Mecca didn't believe in this new version of the God that he has presented to them? Subhanallah means this is Allah's deeds. This is what Allah creates. This is Allah's creation. This is Allah's doing. This is Allah's job, Allah's deeds. The meaning of subhanallah changes around the meaning of where it is mentioned. So when you sit down and you say 100 times subhanallah, you actually are saying absolutely not a thing. And then the messenger adds, am I not just a human sent as a messenger? You can find this in Surah Al-Isra, that's Surah number 17, ayah from 90 all the way to 94. So there was no sign from Allah and no belief from the people of Mecca, and things were a standstill out there. So when Allah didn't grant the people of Mecca those miracles, guess what? He will not grant them to any other after them. So why did the man of religion set on a tangent to invent a whole bunch of miraculous signs and attributed them to the messenger of Allah? Look at it this way. At the very first, when Islam began, Muwatta Malik, Al-Imam Malik, which is one of the early sheikhs in Al-Islam, this guy died in 179 Hijri, i.e. around 180 years after the migration of the messenger, i.e. 170 years after the death of the messenger. Imam Malik was ordered by one of the kings, the Abbasi king, Abu Ja'far Mansur, to write him a book. That book contains the sunnah, as they would like to call it, of the messenger, the way of how Rasulullah implemented Islam in his time. Imam Malik went ahead and asked the people of Al-Madinah how, and he was looking and watching them, studying them, asking them about how they did things. Then Imam Malik went ahead and wrote down what the people of Al-Madinah were doing, because he said they were the closest to the messenger. Imam Malik, in his book, when he wrote, and this is one of the early books, complete books, and I mean complete books, it's not like 10 hadiths, things like that. So in the number of hadiths, it was the number one book compiled, and it was compiled 180 years after the death of the messenger. So he mentioned only three miracles. That's it. Malik mentioned three miracles. Fast forward until somebody called Al-Qadi Iyad. This man died in the year 544, i.e. in the 6th century. All right? That is 365 years after the death of the messenger. When Al-Qadi Iyad came and he wrote his books, he multiplied that number. Al-Qadi Iyad is a Malik, is a follower of Imam Malik. So when he studied and wrote and things like that, he multiplied the number of miracles from three, and he took it all the way to 40 miracles. That's it. So after about 550 years, the miracles were just about 40. Some other books increased it to 100. Guess what? Today we have in the thousands of miracles of the Messenger of Allah. Books have been written about these miracles. It started with three, we have thousands. And long story short, we'll get to this one day when I'll speak about those miracles. But anyway, so the sheikhs tell stories about how the Messenger of Allah had some miracles happen to him before he became messenger. Rocks were talking to him, and how his chest was open, and how Halima Sa'diya, when she wanted to take orphans, you know, they go to Mecca to take babies, everybody took rich people, and Muhammad was of poor family. Of course, they have to create this drama. Muhammad was of poor family, and this woman was actually poor, and she had a very old donkey. She didn't have a lot of milk in her chest to breastfeed a kid. And then when all people had taken their kids, Muhammad was left alone, and she was left, and she was black. So she didn't want to go back home empty-handed. So she goes, you know what? Oh God, let me take this kid. And then she took the kid, and suddenly everything changed in her life. She didn't have milk in her breast. Suddenly it was abandoned. Her donkey, as the books of history say, when they were going to Mecca, was the last one, because it was weak. It couldn't walk. It couldn't do all the kind of stuff. But when Muhammad was on top of it, the donkey became like a Kawasaki. It was fast. And people were asking her, slow down, Halima. We cannot keep up with you. All these are lies. It's incredible the amount of lies. Everything that we know about Rasulullah that is not in Al-Quran is a lie. Like nobody wanted to care for Muhammad. Halima's donkey was old and tired. It couldn't keep up with the rest and was the last one. Halima didn't have milk in her breasts. Halima took Muhammad because she didn't want to go back home empty-handed. Muhammad was poor and cares and... So all what I said. Okay, now let's do some math, my dear sisters and my brothers. Imam Malik was born in the year 93. That is 93 years from the migration, 83 years from the death of Rasulullah. That is almost one century after from the death of the messenger. And he died in year 179. He lived for 84 years. Books of history tell us that Imam Malik went around the city of Al-Madinah asking people what they knew and all these things. And as I said, they documented three hadiths that say he performed some miracles. All right? Okay. But the strangest thing is Imam Malik wrote one book, right? But we have 14 different versions of these books today. There are 14 different, and these different versions, they don't agree with each other. One of them sometimes say you go east, and the other one says go west. One of them says go right, the other one says go left. But that's the problem we face. But anyhow, when we fast forward from 179 Hijri to the year 384, and I'm talking here about 990, almost 1,000 years ago, okay, came a man known Al-Bayhaqi. Al-Bayhaqi is considered the last of the righteous predecessors from the scholars. He wrote a book. That book is called Dala'il al-Nubuwa, the prophethood indications, okay, signs of prophethood. And of course, there are nine versions of this book itself, so it's not like it's nine versions. But anyhow, Al-Bayhaqi, when he wrote this book, gave the following explanation. He says, the purpose of this book is to show the evidences of the Muhammad's prophethood and to inform of his sincerity in his message. May God bless him and grant him peace. In other words, what this man is saying is the following. I wrote this book and collected all these miracles of the messenger in this book to tell people about how true, sincere, real the messenger of Allah was. And I say, Allah has made it clear that the Quran alone is the evidence of the messenger. Allah says, وَمَا كَانَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ يُفْتَرَى مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ, and this Quran was never to have been composed except by Allah. وَلَكِن تَصْدِيقَ الَّذِي بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ, but this Quran is a confirmation of what is between its hand, and what is between its hand is the prophecy of the messenger of Allah. I.e. the Quran is the sole confirmation that validates that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. This is why Allah says, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ بِالْحَقِّ, and we descended to you, speaking to Muhammad, and we descended to you, Muhammad, the book of law, i.e. the Quran, with truth. مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ, confirming what is between its hands of the scripture. So when Allah wants to talk that the Quran confirms the scriptures, Torah and the gospel, Allah uses a terminology speaking about the books. But when Allah speaks about the prophecy of the messenger, Allah doesn't mention the books, he just mentions Muhammad. So when he mentions the books, Allah says, wa muhaiminan alayh, and the Quran is overshadowing, it dominates what is in the Torah and what is in the gospel. Meaning, if the Torah says something is haram, but the Quran says it's halal, that thing there should have been made halal for the Jews and Christians, and the same thing in the gospel. If something is prohibited in the gospel, the Quran says it's halal, then it becomes halal. This domination is explained elsewhere in the Quran, where Allah says, "Inna hadha al-Quran yaqussu 'ala bani Israa'ila akthar alladhi hum fihi yakhtalifun." This Quran truly narrates to the children of Israel most of what they differ over. So the Quran here acts as a judge. So how could Al-Bayhaqi, this much praised sheikh, this last sheikh of the righteous predecessors, how can he call his book evidences of prophecy? Didn't it occur to this scholar that, or those after him, that Allah has said that the Quran is the only miracle that explains that the messenger is Allah's messenger? Each line of the Quran, each word of the Quran is a miraculous sign, is an ayah, a sign, a miracle. And this tells you how much these sheikhs, or those sheikhs of the past, had no clue, really have no clue of what the Quran says. Yes, they tell you they memorize the Quran, but that's that. They would just recite it, as the sheikhs of today. Subhanallah, there are tons of ayahs that says go east, the hadith say go west, the sheikhs would go west, and when you tell them it's in the Quran, it's like you told them it is in the Bible. They have no idea, even though they recite it. And I had this experience over and over. I tell him, Allah says this in the Quran. And he goes, yes. And I say, why do you preach against it? But again, as Mark Twain, remember the American novelist born in 1835, he said, the trust of the innocent is the liar's most useful tool. When someone wants to lie to you, your trust is his or her best tool. And our trust in our sheikhs have been the worst thing we ever did with them. And that gave them authority over us. Saying that the narratives collected at the end of the 4th century act as a validation to messenger's mission is preposterous. Because this goes against the Quran. Allah says the Quran itself. So what Al-Bayhaqi and the men of religion are saying is that the Quran was not good enough of an evidence to support the messenger in his message. How difficult is it to put the Quran together? Collect the ayat which talk about the same subject. Sit down, you know, Mr. Al-Bayhaqi and Ibn Kathir and all these sheikhs. Sit down, collect all the ayat which speak about the same topic, and you will get to the result of what you want. But it's either they ignore the Quran completely, which is apparent in so many of their works, or what they do is they do an evil act, and that is they truncate an ayah. They cut it off from its context, then give it a distorted and twisted meanings. And that's it. You have a new, and that's why they say, oh, whatever the messenger gave you, take it. And whatever he forbids you, do not take it. And they say, see, that's about Sunnah. No, it's not about Sunnah. Allah was talking about the spoils of war. But when they truncated and they cut this ayah from its context, you can use it for anything else. When we truncate, when we cut the ayahs from their context, I can make fornication halal for you. Because you can cut things, and it's incredible what they have done. Wallah, it's incredible. But anyhow, so though the book that Al-Bayhaqi wrote about the miracles of the messenger has been overly praised and by a huge number of scholars, I can say that anyone who cares enough to study the Quran would find that all of these sheikhs, including Al-Bayhaqi, were wrong. The only ever miracle that the messenger of Allah needed is the word of Allah. Let me tell you something. What is bigger? What is more significant? Is it the word spoken by Allah or water coming out from the hand of a human? It's the words of Allah. They come from Him. It's the highest. Look, when Allah spoke to Musa, that was the highest that Allah did bestow on Musa, speaking to him, opening the sea to Musa, compared to the words of Allah spoken to Musa, is nothing. So the Quran is like Allah speaking to Musa. Any other miracle that they say, which of course didn't happen, is like Musa with his stick throwing it and become serpent, eating what the sorcerers have done, or opening the sea and things like that. But anyhow, so that is, now let us jump to the next point. I want to speak about is Al-Buraq. Al-Buraq is the description of Al-Buraq as in the hadith narratives, okay? They say it is a two-winged horse. It is a blessed and holy animal. That the messengers of Allah, that the messengers of Allah, including Ibrahim and Muhammad, have used before. They say that if a messenger wanna go from A to B and it's very far, they would use Al-Buraq. And usually books of Sirah and history would mention stories of two prophets, and that is Ibrahim and Muhammad. But anyhow, they say it is also that it is a two-winged horse that Hajar and Ismail used. But anyhow, so these are just people speaking. There is nothing that says that. But what is true, that is in Al-Bukhari and other books, is that Ibrahim used to visit his wife Hajar and her son Ishmael after he deposited them in Mecca and went back all the way to Iraq or Palestine. And then he would travel, it's thousands of miles away, and then he would jump on Al-Buraq and he goes there. In the books of hadith narratives, as in Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmidhi, An-Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, and this is, there are great numbers of hadith and sheikhs who commented, explained, discussed what these books of hadith said. Example, An-Nawawi, Ibn Hajar, they say that Al-Buraq, or the two-winged horse, is an animal that. Now they're gonna explain to you what this animal is. They say it's bigger than a donkey, smaller than a mule. It's traveling speed, it puts its hoof, you know, the feet of a horse, as far as its eyesight reaches, i.e. the animal looks the end of the horizon where it sees, that's where it's going to put its hooves. Meaning it's extremely, extremely fast. Its mane, the hair growing on the neck of the horse, is made of soft pearls woven by ruby roads and shining with lights. Okay, so this, you start getting an idea, okay, so this is not a horse really, because if the mane is soft pearls woven with ruby roads and shining with light, we're talking about some out of space creature. Anyhow, they say its ears are made of green emeralds. Its eyes are like an extremely lit planet, which light is like the rays of the sun. His path is lit for it as if it were the light of the sun, i.e. at night when it travels, it's almost like a car. Now we're talking about a car, all right? It is a white horse. His breath is like that of a son of Adam, i.e. it breathes like us. I don't know how horses breathe different than us, but anyhow. And then they say, only Allah is capable to describe this burak, this two-winged horse, properly. So this is the description, and this description exists in a variety of different books. When the Messenger of Allah, they say, arrived from the Battle of Tabuk, that is 1 year or less before the death's prophet, or in other narration of this event, they say Khaybar, 3 years before the prophet's death. And this, that's why the hadith is so a minefield, it's so weak, we should never ever have fallen to the hadith, because it's narrated by narrators and they just go to their memories. It's not a revelation from Allah as the sheikhs lied to us. See, the narrator was doubtful about which battle it was. So how can I trust the person about what they say? But anyhow, they say when the messenger entered his house, coming back from an army trip, he comes back home, a draft raised a curtain which was hung in front of a room, revealing some dolls, and we're talking about the dolls of Aisha, which belonged to his wife Aisha. So she's a little girl playing with stuff. Allah, it makes me cringe every time I say this. I'm talking here about a man aged 54, married to a girl 6-7 years. But anyhow, they say that these animals, these toys, these dolls belong to Aisha. Then the eyes of the messenger fell on them. And he asked, what are these? Aisha replied, these are my dolls. And among them, there was a horse with wings. It was made of rags because she made them. And so the messenger asked, what is it this I see among them? So he pointed to the horse. And she replied, a horse. So the messenger asked, what are those on it? She replied, two wings. He asked, a horse with two wings? She answered, have you not heard that Suleiman, you know, the prophet of Allah, Solomon, had horses with wings? When she said that, she said, thereupon the messenger of Allah laughed so hard, I could see his molar teeth, meaning he opened his mouth very big because he was really, it's almost like rolling on the floor with laughter. This hadith is authenticated by Al-Albani. It's considered sahih. It's found in Abu Dawood and Al-Bayhaqi. So as you can see, the messenger of Allah had no clue about this horse, because if he had been on one with two wings, he would have already known it's the burak he wrote, but he had no clue. And that's why when she told him about Suleiman, he started laughing. You see, Aisha, why didn't Aisha tell him, messenger of Allah, you've already been on one, remember when you went from Mecca to Jerusalem? You were on one, it's the same horse. But no, she told him, didn't you know, have you not heard that Suleiman had a horse with wings? The messenger had no clue about a horse with two wings, much less him having ridden one. So before I move to the next point, here is yet another ayah from the Quran, which clearly states that there was no ascension to heavens or any trip anywhere that was miraculous. Okay? And before I read the content of the ayah that I want to do that, I would like to mention a little bit about the surah in which this ayah exists. Because usually when Allah mentions an ayah in a particular surah, which was revealed in a particular time, it carries more than it's let to be known. The ayah I'm going to deal with is in Surah Al-An'am. Al-An'am is the surah number 6, which they translate always with the cattle, but it does not mean the cattle. Al-An'am comes from An-Ni'am, are the bounties and gifts of Allah. In that surah, Allah talks to us about few of the gifts that He has gifted us with. So it's not, the cattles are part of those gifts, but this surah doesn't talk about the animals themselves. But anyway, the ayat I'm going to speak about are from the ayat 33 to 37. So it's surah number 6 from 33 to 37. Surah Al-An'am was entirely revealed in Mecca, which means the people of Mecca had enough time to hear it, understand it, comprehend it, then fight it long enough to reject it. Therefore, there was no chance for them to not have heard it. It was revealed in Mecca. Furthermore, all scholars agree that Surah Al-An'am, the surah number 6, is one of the very few surahs that was revealed in one single time. It is 165 ayah long, meaning Jibreel had brought it down in one go. There is a scholar called Ibn Ashur. He's a great Salafi scholar from Tunisia. He died in 1973, aged 94 years old, so he's not very far from us. One of his most celebrated works is his book of Tafsir. But anyhow, as I said, he's very well respected amongst the Salafis, so that's what he did. Here is what he says. He gathered what the books of Salafis say, and he put it in his book. So he says, after great research, Surah Al-An'am, the Surah of the Bounties, is the 55th Surah in Revelation, i.e. 54 Surahs were revealed before it. But in Al-Quran we have today, it's the number 6, because the way the people in the past, Uthman and people who came at that time, when they went ahead and arranged the surah, they did from the biggest to the shortest. That's the reason why we have the Quran the way we have it today. But anyhow, so Surah Al-An'am is the 55th surah. Surah Al-An'am is the most comprehensive surah in the entire Quran, which compiles the state of the Arabs before Islam and how they reacted to Islam. If you want to understand how the people of Mecca reacted to Islam and how they were living before Islam, go to Surah number 6, study it. It will draw a picture about these Arabs. Surah Al-An'am, Surah number 6, presented to people and to us and to everyone the pure faith in a unique educational way. Surah Al-An'am asked so many hypothetical questions that Allah asks, and then what He does, He answers them. Allah cuts the way in front of people. So He says, and they say, or they would say, and then Allah would answer it. Surah Al-An'am alerted people to the sleeping intellectual powers that Allah equipped humans with. And in it, in so many ayat, Allah called people to use their minds, to use their brains, think. Something that Muslims don't do these days. They just listen to the sheikhs like that. They don't think. And that is very sad. Surah Al-An'am presented the monotheism, the tawheed, in a very logical way. And it invokes the opponents to lead a rational approach to the charms. What I'm trying to say here is that Allah has done it in a beautiful way to lead the enemies of the oneness of Allah to accept it, because He asks them about Who created this? Who did thus? They cannot say, oh, three gods, because they cannot prove it. And to them, it's only one God. And Allah has laid down the Quran in a manner that when he asks a question, it always goes back to him. The divine command of قُلْ, say, and this, whenever Allah says قُلْ, say, it takes the human factor, it takes Muhammad out of the equation. As I said before, Rasulullah, the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad is not part of Al-Islam. Yes, we believe in him as a Messenger of Allah, just like we believe in any other messenger. But Muhammad is dead. If Muhammad was part of Al-Islam, he would never ever have died. The Quran is part of Al-Islam, that's why it stayed with us. When the Sheikh wanted to make Muhammad part of Al-Islam, they invented the Hadith. But Muhammad is not part of Al-Islam. You see, Muhammad was supposed to deliver Al-Islam to us as a messenger, die, gone, Jazakallah khair, Allah will reward you on judgment day, end of it. Now we are left as the Quran and Allah. Muhammad was never, ever supposed to endure after his death. That's unlike what's happening today. But anyway, the command of قُلْ, say, was mentioned 44 times. There is no other surah in Al-Quran that has this. 44 times Allah orders Muhammad to say to the people of Mecca. You see, Rasulullah was not a man who would call people to Islam by his own arguments or how clever he was. No, he always recited the Quran, something we don't do that. But anyhow, Surah Al-An'am is a great example of how Allah uses the messenger to converse with the non-believers. That Allah talks to the non-believers through Muhammad because he is a human being. Surah Al-An'am is a true representative of the Meccan era. What was going on back then? So as I said earlier on, if you wish to know how the Arabs were, how they interacted with Islam, how they reacted with it, read number 6, the Surah 6. Surah Al-An'am, the Surah number 6, is the only Surah that contains the attribute of Allah Ar-Rabb, the Lord, more than 50 times. Because bounties given to human beings are done by the Rabb, by the Lord. So Allah mentions that him as Ar-Rabb, as the giver, as the undertaker, 50 times. In this surah, Allah calls upon humans to use their sight, vision, intellect far more than in any other surah. As a matter of fact, Allah has done it 44 times, calling humans to think for themselves. As I said earlier on, Muslims don't do that. We don't think of ourselves. They listen to the Sheikh and they don't question. The Sheikh, subhanAllah, I find it extremely difficult. You go to a Sheikh and he tells you, oh, drink the urine of a camel. And Muslims don't question, they drink it. If the urine of a camel was any good, medical world, the pharmacies would have discovered it by now. But no. You go to Saudi Arabia, I've seen it, go on YouTube. You find the Bedouins, the Salafis, they wash their faces with the urine of a camel. It's incredible. I don't know what, but anyhow. In this surah, Allah reveals to the Arab the exact 10 commandments that he revealed in the Torah and the Bible. And with this, Allah establishes that the Quran is a continuation and in some places an upgrade from the past books, i.e. a new fresh start. In this surah Al-An'am, the surah number 6, there was a lot of one-to-one confrontations, challenges, demands, and heated, if not hostile, debates between the Arabs that refused this new messenger, the Quran, the orders, do's and don'ts, and Allah. At all costs, the Arabs must not find any defects or weak points to this new religion, and Allah did to convey that. So when they asked all these questions, ascend to heaven, do this, they were looking for pitfalls, weaknesses. But Allah did not entertain them. So for us to say that the messenger has gone in Al-Israa and Al-Mi'raj in year 10 is crying the Quran, accusing Al-Quran of being a liar. Because the Quran doesn't say that the Messenger of Allah had gone and had to heaven. It doesn't say that at all. Anyhow, in this fierce and relentless battle of thoughts between Allah and humans, yes, you heard it right. I meant really the relentless battle of thoughts and beliefs between Allah and humans. You see, Allah is doing his best within the boundaries of what he decided to convince people to believe in him. And by allowing humans to be totally free to do as they please, and by not controlling their wills and desires, Allah did in fact give them, and us of course, full freedom to disobey him at will, without Allah being able to affect our freedom. You see, today, if someone wants to stand in the middle of the road and praise Allah, they're free to do that. And if someone decides to stand in the middle of the road and insult Allah, guess what? Totally free. It's not like a rock is going to fall on him or that. Nothing. Why? Because Allah wants us to be 100% free in the actions we choose to do. Because judgment day relies 100% on this freedom. You see, the percentage of accountability on judgment day depends on the percentage of freedom. Meaning, if you have 100% freedom today on earth to do as you please, you are held accountable on judgment day 100%. If you have 73%, then you are held accountable 75%. If you have 50% freedom on earth, then you are held accountable 50% on judgment day. And let's say on earth you have zero freedom to do as you like. On judgment day, you are held accountable 0%. What I mean by that? If you have no choice on earth, if someone sticks a gun to your head or to your child's head, and they will tell you, insult Allah. You never done that. They say, insult Allah. Say the worst things. And they keep the gun on your child's head. And guess what? You start insulting Allah. Do you have 100% over what you are doing? You do not. You are compelled. Compulsion meaning you have 0% freedom to do as you like. You are compelled. You're forced to do something. When we are forced on earth to do something, when our freedom is 100% taken away from us, guess what? On judgment day, we are not held responsible. Again, the percentage of accountability on judgment day depends on the percentage of freedom on earth today. This is why Allah will not interfere with what you do. Do say what you do. Do what you say. You've got people killing people. You have monstrous parents that sexually abuse their little girls. And Allah does not interfere. Why? Because it's the 100% policy that Allah has put on earth, and Allah will not break it. So when the inhabitants of Mecca objected the Messenger of Allah in a way or another, Allah would enter with them in a debate to reason with them, to talk to them, to converse with them, to influence their understanding. But if they don't want to do that, hey, no big deal. Allah doesn't care because he has judgment day. This is why Allah says in the Quran, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ, speaking to Muhammad, and had your Lord wanted, لَآمَنَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كُلُّهُمْ جَمِيعًا, all those on earth would have been made to believe, all of them. But if Allah forces us to believe, that means he has removed our 100% freedom. On judgment day, he cannot reward us because we were deprived of our freedom to choose. We were compelled to believe. Then Allah says something to Rasulullah and he tells to the messenger, "Afa anta tukrihu an-nas hatta yakunu mu'minin?" Therefore, are you, Muhammad, going to compel people so that they become believers? Yes, and this is in Surah number 10, Surah Yunus, ayah number 99. Our sheikhs compel us. Our sheikhs kill us if you do this or that. But no, Allah doesn't want to do that. Allah wants you to be totally free. It is for this reason that Allah does not compel anyone to believe or allow anyone to force anyone to believe. Belief is a free will option that none should tamper with. Contrary to what the sheikhs and salafis and the men of religion have done and claimed. Our duty is not to take a human Islam to people, but rather invite them to look into the Quran. You see, when they told us that our duty is to take Islam to the nations, and exactly what they did is they used the armies, and they guess what? They went to the people. Today, when you hear Islam was spread with the sword, Muslims will say, no, it was merchants and they were business people. That is a lie. Our books of history witness that Islam was taken at the top of a sword. Show me a piece of land from Morocco and all where the Muslim world is today. You will find that armies have taken that. You also hear people in our books of history, they will tell you companions' graves have died as far as the northern part of Turkey. They went for jihad in the sake of Allah. No, the jihad of what they call the jihad is going to take Islam to the armies. In our books of fiqh, they tell us that when the Muslim armies arrive at the borders of a country, they will send three conditions to the king. Condition number one, we come here to your country to give da'wah in your city. Okay, without any hindrance or objection, you should let us go. Meaning, if the Muslims were strong, they would bring the army, and they have done it. They've taken the armies to the southern parts. They were about 70 miles or kilometers away from Paris. And if they had conquered Paris, they would have come to England. What happens is the army gets stationed at the back. Then the governor or the king or the general of the army, of the Muslim army, would send a messenger to speak to the king. The first condition is we come here, we are Muslims, we come to England, we want to give da'wah, we want to invite people to Islam. And we don't want you to hinder or object us. Imagine this happening. Then if the king agrees, then the Muslims will come here and they will start talking to people, believe in Allah. As if Allah didn't ask us to do this. Politics have. And it is in our books of politics. But anyway, let's say the king of England, Henry VIII, says, no, who are you? You come to my land, you want to preach your ideologies, and you don't want us to hinder you, no objection, you want to do in our lands what you do. Who are you? Then the next thing comes in, they will say, okay, if you don't want us to give da'wah in your country or tribe or city, whatever, then you must pay us a protection tax. We become like the mafia. And this is what they call jizya. Jizya meaning you pay money in the place of us fighting you and killing you. You see, and then this would be a yearly payment that the country or tribe or city would make to the Muslims. If the city, let's say England, refuses the jizya or this protection tax, guess what comes next? It's war in 3 days. And then when the Muslims manage to conquer the land, they take it. This happened in Morocco, this happened in North Africa, this happened in Libya, this happened in Egypt, this happened everywhere. Muslim lands were grabbed with the sword. The huge majority of the countries today have had Islam injected in them with the sword. That's why we have conflicts until today. Al-Iraq they didn't come free will. They were forced into Islam. And that is what politics does to us. But anyway, this is just a side note. I'm coming to the hour. I will stop here and carry on, inshallah, in part number 2. Again, this is your brother Abdus Salam, and this is the last part of Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj, and off to part number 2. Salam.